Northwest Chicago to participate, and thank you for your presence with us this evening. We are so excited because we are the first diocese in the United States to actually have discussion around this movie, led by its shepherd. So today, it's a great joy to have with you James Herner, who works in the Archdiocese of Chicago and stayed for quite some time with the Society of Jesus, who will lead our conversation with the Cardinal, and then our pastor, Cardinal Blaise Supic. We have also, as we have a number of small notes and pens which are traveling throughout the theater. If you at any point will write, you'd like to write a question for the Cardinal or for us, we'd be happy to answer those. We most likely won't get to most of them, as you can imagine, in the next 25 minutes. Yet what we'll do is we'll use those for future discussions with the Cardinal. So we'll use them for theology and pop, which is upcoming this summer for people in their 20s and 30s, as well as for other discussions which we are planning in the next few months. So thank you for your presence. And now for about 25 minutes, we'll engage in this conversation around the movie Silence and our faith.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Father Peter, for setting this up with your team. I'm really grateful. I wanted to just make a couple of introductory remarks and then leave it open to questions. I think it's important to highlight that Endo was writing at a time when there was a great Catholic literary revival going on. He's in the mainstream of people like Graham Greene and Evan Waugh, Walker Percy, Flannery Connor, people like McGee. And their interest was in reshaping the discussion about Catholicism and the Catholic faith, which seemed to be so encrusted by externals, and that the interior life was being ignored. And so, as McGee said, the sinner is at the heart of Christianity, not Christ. And that God, like Thompson the poet says, is the hound of heaven, who's always coming and seeking after us. So I think it's important to situate this story of Silence within that literary tradition and literary genre. The second thing I think is important to notice is that this notion of silence is ironically brought to our attention by the ongoing conversation, not really conversation, monologue of Father Enriquez. He's the one who's doing all the talking. And so there's a point at which not only is he not leaving room in his life for silence to listen to God, but he's also not allowing those that he comes to evangelize to say anything. He has all the answers. And that's a very important moment in his life where he has to let go of that and his pride that he has all the answers. And it's in that particular moment when he has to put the word into flesh and not just leave it in the world of ideas and dominating the discussion, but he has to actually do something to show his love, to let the word become flesh that Christ speaks to him. And there's a real irony in the way that unfolds, I think. And the final thing that I would say is that there is a kenosis or an emptying that goes on here with Rodriguez. And it's interesting that Pope Benedict in Deus Caritas Est, in God's Love, said that what God is known for in terms of his holiness is that God turns against himself. Now, there were some theologians who didn't like that phrase. But there is an emptying of God here, and that has to be replicated in our own faith lives, where we have to let go of those things that we feel that we're hanging on to as real supports. And at the end of the movie, it's really clear that Rodriguez has allowed his faith to leave behind the externals to the point where the internals are important. And we see that in, as he's holding that cross. It's as though, even though there's a flame all around him, there's a fire within him where he's holding onto that cross where he couldn't verbalize his faith anymore, but it was lived in an interior way. So those are the kinds of thoughts, maybe to get our discussion going and your own questions, that I wanted to make at the outset. And I'm going to let you kind of take the lead with questions maybe that people are posing or that you have.
Yeah, thanks so much, Cardinal.
Some of the questions have already come in, and some of them relate thematically to thoughts I've had reflecting on this movie. Thank you for situating it in context. One of the fascinating things to me is the reaction of some believers and non-believers alike to the film. They say, what were the missionaries even doing there in the first place? They say that it was an affront to the Japanese. As someone who spent many years in the old mission territory of the Native Americans in South Dakota, how do you respond to such a question? Is it disrespectful or imperialist to try to convert people to Christianity? And what do you think leads men and women to become missionary disciples?
I recall that phrase of Pope Francis a couple of years ago when he was talking to missionaries who were going off to a missionary land. He said, remember that the Holy Spirit was there before you got there. And so I think that there is a need to put aside one's pride. And Rodriguez was unwilling to see that these people had a faith, were being touched by God, that needed to be expressed. This is a whole issue of acculturation, of whether or not the universal church and all of us who are missionaries who go out to the other people to share our faith can actually say that we're going to learn from other people and their experience. And I think that I lived with Native Americans too, and I can tell you I learned more about my own Catholic faith from them than anybody else in many ways. They have, for instance, a much thinner curtain between time and eternity than we have. There's a sense of the communion of saints that is very alive. So sometimes that's why silence is important. The missionaries have to shut up sometimes and let the people express what's going on in their life, because faith is a dialogue. It's not just handed on. It grows in an organic exchange that takes place. So that's what I think that a new missionary spirit has to do that. It can't be the dominant. And when you link the missionaries with imperialism, it's a deadly combination. And we've seen that here in our own country.
Yeah, there's that beautiful scene where Inquisitor Inouye is saying, well, which of the wives would you have him take? Would you have him take Portugal? And he says, no, I'd have him take the church. So that relates very much to an idea of sort of separating Christianity from the dominant ideology that might drive people to be there. Another question here that relates to something that I was reflecting on is, in a lot of ways, it's a very traumatic and tragic film in its portrayal of Christianity in medieval Japan. But we know that there are Christians in the world today and people of other faiths persecuted. And your own titular church of St. Bartholomew was dedicated by Pope St. John Paul to the memory of martyrs in the 20th and 21st centuries. In sometimes much less drastic ways, the teaching of the church is under threat in America with laws around abortion, nuclear arsenals, assisted suicide, death penalty. How ought we to witness to our faith in public? Does the faith have a place in public life?
Well, it does, because people have a place in public life. And people are, their whole life is, there's aspirations are circumscribed by their beliefs. Everybody has beliefs. I think that it's a myth that people don't come into discussions in public square without beliefs. Everybody has beliefs, one way or another. Atheist has belief. There's a great book written by Father Michael Buckley, a Jesuit, that atheism is a tradition of well over 200 years. So people do come into public square with their beliefs. But what's important, I think, for us in the Catholic Church that sometimes wanted to dominate this discussion is that we have to realize that we're there to propose, not impose. Again, a phrase of Benedict XVI. We're there to have a dialogue take place. A good Jesuit, Avery Dulles, Cardinal Dulles, once said that it takes a lot of courage to sit across from somebody and give them permission to tell you why they think you're wrong. And so I think that kind of respectful dialogue has to be, we're losing that in our political discourse today, in our public discourse. And I think the church can help revive the importance of dialogue, as Pope Francis has been saying. So we all have our beliefs, but let's sit down and listen to one another.
And that takes a lot of courage too, just to simply listen. A little bit about the prayer in the movie. The whole movie, some people in reviewing it have called it a prayer. And Rodriguez, as you said, he's constantly talking to God, or talking at God for the majority of the movie. Have you yourself tried this kind of prayer where you're sort of extemporaneously talking to God? It comes from, one of the places you can find it is in the spiritual exercises, this notion of colloquy. How do we know when what we're hearing is God's voice? What are sort of the benchmarks that can help us discern? So if we're sitting in dialogue with someone, how do we know how God is calling us to respond?
I think that that's at the heart of the movie. I think that you have to be careful that you grab a hold of certainty too quickly, that you are certain all immediately. Because I think that there is an importance here, and I think Endo does not want us to judge whether or not Rodriguez did the right thing or wrong thing. What he wants us to do is to say, I can't judge what he did, because I'm not that person, and I can't predetermine whether or not God was calling him. I can't be certain either way. In our own spiritual lives too, I think you always have to have a dialogue between doubt and faith. I always question where I'm going, not to the point where it leaves me paralyzed and inactive to take any action, but where you always have to realize that there is something more that God's calling you to. And it's not that maybe God isn't, you're getting mixed messages, but maybe God's not telling you everything at this time, and you got to hang on to more. There's that wonderful word that we learned in theology, in studying the theology of faith, appoggiarsi a Dio, which the Italians say, you have to lean on God. You have to kind of hold on for the ride. And it's not whether something is true or false, it's whether that is complete or incomplete. And God's holding, you're holding on to God for the next phase, next part of the response.
In terms of the movie, and we spoke a little bit before we came on stage of that final scene where you see that he still has the crucifix that the Jisama had, that Mokishi gave him. And as I was praying about that after the first time I had seen it in the entire week, I was wondering, what is this movie saying to people who might say, I'm spiritual, but I'm not religious? Because there's a very particular and sort of evil reason why he has to hold his faith so quietly. What do you think a movie like this says to people who might say, well, I'm spiritual but not religious? What holds people back from really embracing religion or a faith?
Well, I think that it's because there's been a domination of the externals over the internal life. And I think that scene crystallizes the issue, because this man had everything of the external taken away from him because of his circumstances. But that forced him to live an interior life. And it was an interior life in which he held on with Jesus. So that, like I said earlier, that fire that was all around him were the externals. It didn't matter. What mattered was the interior fire within him. But I also know that that was an extraordinary circumstance because of the oppression that he served. I know myself that my interior life only grows if I share it. If I just leave it to me and Jesus, to me and God, it doesn't grow, it doesn't go anywhere. Because it is like that Easter celebration that we have at the vigil. That life has to be passed on. And when it does, there is something that everybody gains as a result of that. So a true interior faith, a true spirituality, it seems to me, because we're relational beings, always has to be shared. And that's what being religious is. The word religion means link. You're linked to other people. You're yoked to other people.
And speaking of that, what do you make of Tajichiro, that character, and his relationship with Javier Rodriguez? It's very, very complicated, and a lot of it goes to the heart of the pride that Rodriguez is really serving towards the beginning of the movie. But some people are wondering, okay, which one of these guys is more of a Judas? Which one of these guys is more of a Peter? Which one of these guys am I more like? Do you see yourself in these characters at all?